Belinda Audio and the O'Brien Press present this unabridged recording of A Quarter Glass of Milk, The Rawness of Grief and the Power of the Mountains, written by Moire O'Sullivan and read by Emma Lowe. To Leona and Julie, for always being there for me and my boys. Chapter 1. Last Year. I meant to get in touch last year, he said. It's just, I didn't know what to say. I froze, people pushing past us on either side. The mere mention of last year pinned me to the ground. I hadn't seen Owen in years, even though we had been friends back in the day. I wasn't surprised to see him, however. It was inevitable we were going to bump into each other at a gathering such as that evening's. It was the night of the premiere of Coming Home, a film about emigrant and mountain runner Paddy O'Leary, returning to Ireland to attempt the Wicklow Round. I too had completed this grueling challenge. I was the first person to successfully summit the Wicklow Mountain's 26 peaks within 24 hours. There was no way I was missing the screening of this feat of endurance that had been such an integral part of my own life. Owen, too, was a mountain runner, one who had cruised the Wicklow Round on the day of his own attempt. For him, it was just one more thing to add to his phenomenal list of athletic achievements. Over a decade had passed since both Owen and I had completed our Wicklow Rounds. So much had happened in the intervening years. But last year, the time that Owen spoke of now, well, that was different. It's okay, don't worry about it, I replied quickly, swiftly brushing his comment away. Owen wasn't the only person who had no idea what to say to me. It was kind of him, though, to bring it up, to acknowledge my terrible loss. I had encountered others who were well aware of what had happened, yet jovially asked whether I was still racing in the mountains, when that was the furthest thing from my mind. Owen was brave enough not to ignore what was foremost in my life. It's just that, Owen continued, I wanted to let you know my dad died when I was 5. He then looked me square in the eye and said, your kids will be okay. My throat choked hard as he said those final words. Now it was I, not Owen, who did not know what to say. Here was Owen, not telling me that he was sorry for my loss, or telling me how hard it was going to be. Instead, here was Owen, who had excelled at so much, in a few simple words offering me hope. My boys and I would be okay. Chapter 2. That Day. I looked at the clock. It read 9:45 a.m. He was late. My husband Pete was never late. We had planned to visit Pete's sister 2 days after Christmas. He had gotten up early that morning, a surprising yet welcome move. We had a long drive ahead of us, at least 6 hours, so I was looking forward to making the most of the winter's daylight. Even better was the fact that Pete was dressed for a morning run. We need to leave at 10 a.m. at the latest, I told him. So if you could be back by 9:30, that would be great. He nodded slowly, his eyes fixed on the bowl of steaming porridge that I had given him, which he now cradled in one hand. It was still dark outside, but he had his fluorescent vest on, so would be visible on the road. A run would be good. He had not been well of late, and running was meant to help. Why don't you bring Tom? I asked. Our dog instantly jolted his head upright at the mention of his name. Tom was going to be cooped up in the car with us for the long journey, so an early morning run with his master would do both the world of good. No, Pete replied. I was taken aback. His abrupt reaction didn't make sense. I didn't want to push it, however. The fact that Pete was up, dressed, eating, and about to exercise already made it a good day. I knew Pete's route off by heart. He was a remarkable creature of habit. Turning out of our front drive, he would run down the road for a kilometre before turning left into Kilbroney Forest. He would then run up the hill, following the Mournes trail, until he reached the car park at Yellow River. From there, he would run back home via the road to complete his 10-kilometre circuit. It took him an hour, always 1 hour. By 9:45 a.m., an hour 15 had passed. I was starting to get worried. Leaving our house, I walked towards the road to see if there were any signs of Pete. As I stood at our gateway, scanning the road to my left and right through the dim December light, my landlord, Michael, appeared on the other side of the road. "Have you seen Pete?" I asked, dispensing with pleasantries while trying to maintain a sense of calm. My head was muddled with what could have happened to my partner. As he shook his head, I remembered that Michael had a four-wheel drive and keys to the gate that allowed vehicles to enter the forest. "It's just that he's late. Could you maybe go see if he's had an accident?" I said. "He could be injured somewhere on the forest road. It's just not like him." As he returned to his home to gather his keys, I ran back to our house. I knew Pete would kill me for what I'd do next, but I had no other option. Only a few days beforehand, Pete had been discharged from hospital. He had been treated there for depression before being handed over to a home-based care team. The team had given me their contacts in case of anything. I dialed the number on their card. "He's gone missing," I said to the man who answered the phone. "I know it's probably nothing, but I just thought you should know." I had convinced myself that Pete had probably gone for a wander up one of the surrounding hills, above the forest tree line. Knowing him, Pete had worked out that if he delayed us by just enough, we would be too late to leave that day, and the trip would eventually get called off. Pete didn't like travelling much of late. I explained that my landlord was currently checking the trail to see if Pete was lying there, injured. "If he comes back saying there's no sign, call the police," the man said. I balked at the suggestion. If Pete hobbled home only to see police cars parked on our drive, I knew he would lose the plot. Pete had managed thus far to keep news of his illness within close confines. Informing the police was akin to broadcasting it publicly on social media. When Michael returned without Pete in tow, I knew I had little choice. Maybe it would be better if the police got involved and the community came to know that he was not well. Maybe it would be a silver lining. My 999 call was answered quickly, setting the train in motion. The policeman's questions came thick and fast. What was he wearing? Where was he going? When was he meant to return? Did he have any friends he could be visiting locally? Did he bring his wallet or phone? I stood outside the house in the winter air as I took the call, hoping I would catch sight of Pete returning from his run. Once I saw him, I planned to hang up as if nothing had happened, so that we could go back to how things were. The policeman told me that he'd send out a team to help coordinate a search. I'd agreed to whatever was suggested if it meant Pete could come home safely. In the meantime, the policeman told me to phone anyone who I thought Pete could have gone and visited. I quickly realised there was no one Pete knew well enough to engage in a social call. We had lived in the village of Ross Trevor for over 3 years, and yet Pete hadn't made friends in the same way I had. He hadn't done the school pickups and mingled with parents or joined the local running groups. The only person I could think of was John, a former neighbour of ours, but John now lived a 30-minute drive away over narrow rural roads. There was no way Pete could have run there. Regardless, I dialed John's number and apologised for disturbing him in the midst of the Christmas holidays. "I know this is a long shot," I said, "but is Pete there? It's just that he's gone missing." I still don't recall our conversation, consequence, I now realise, of my mind drawing a veil across that day. What happened in those next few days was probably so traumatic that memory failure is the only way to protect me. A call was then made to Peter's sister, who we were meant to visit, to tell her we were delayed. I didn't want to alarm her, as I knew Pete would be home soon, but I just wanted to let her know that our anticipated arrival time of 4 p.m. was no longer feasible. A police team soon arrived at the door, two officers, both looking so young. There was part of me that didn't want to distress these millennials with my troubles, when they had surely more pressing things to do. They asked the same questions as the ones I had answered on the phone, and I tried to be consistent and clear. I also gave them a photo of Pete to show to locals during their inquiries, in case it helped track him down. My emotions were in check throughout, knowing there was no point in hysterics, because Pete would be home soon. It was only when John and his wife Nina arrived at my door as the officers were leaving that I realised something was maybe wrong. I hadn't asked them to come. John's eyes were raw and red. What did he know that I didn't? I had allowed John and Nina into our inner circle many months before. I had told him Pete was unwell, that he needed a bit of help. I had let John know that Pete wasn't answering his phone and had stopped working. John and Nina immediately invited us over for drinks and dinner. They hadn't seen Pete in a couple of weeks, a consequence of his self-enforced isolation. It was obvious that Pete had lost weight, one of the many apparent symptoms of his growing illness. "Are you on a new diet?" John joked as Pete played around with the chunks of chicken on his plate. Pete would normally wolf down John's excellent cooking. "Are you going to let us in on your secret?" This, I knew, was Pete's chance to say, "Yeah, I'm not doing too well these days." Instead, Pete nodded quietly. "Diet, yeah, that's it," he mumbled back, avoiding all eye contact. Before I could say to John that he shouldn't have come, that there was no need for any fuss, John said, "Hope for the best, but expect the worst." I was stunned, too shocked to provide a counter-argument. John then turned to the police team who were now outside to help them with their inquiries. Nina slipped into our house, volunteering to stay with me while we waited. The daughter and wife of my landlord, Dee Dee and Marie, soon came to the house and asked my boys, Aaron and Cahill, if they'd like to visit their resident chickens. I hadn't noticed that their childish noises had already faded deep into the background, so distracted had I become. They needed to be looked after by someone who was fully functioning. The chance of feeding chickens seemed to them the opportunity of a lifetime. As they donned their wellies and jackets, Dee Dee suggested she stay behind with Nina and I to help coordinate the search. Dee Dee, with her extensive contacts throughout the community, was already way ahead of me. She had messaged local mountain bikers and asked them to keep an eye out for Pete if they happened to be out for a spin. Though I knew Pete wouldn't have purposely gone on the forest's mountain bike trails, if he had had a bad fall, he could potentially be lying on one, calling out for help. Dee Dee continued to flick through her long list of friends, trying to think of anyone else who could help. "Would it be okay if I called Marty from the Mournes Mountain Rescue Team?" Dee Dee then said. I hesitated, not wanting to bother them. I knew the Mountain Rescue Team is made up purely of volunteers. These men and women were probably looking forward to some downtime after the Christmas rush. The last thing I wanted was for them to abandon their festive plans to trawl the forests and mountains for my missing husband. It was just that if Pete was hurt, he needed to get home fast. I was deeply worried that he was cold, tired, hungry, afraid. If someone, anyone, could help locate him, I was more than willing to accept their help. I would suffer the consequences later when Pete berated me for overreacting to his absence. So, Dee Dee called Marty, who immediately agreed to assemble the mountain rescue team. I felt embarrassed, yet extremely grateful. She then slipped away to check on my kids and to make sure they were still.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.